welcome to another edition of Magic TV. I am Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Luis Scott-Vargas. We're bringing back probably Luis's favorite gimmick in all of the show, for those of you who remember. You once did, what was it called?
Hit or Myth. Me and my previous co-host, Mashi, not to be confused with our dying co-host, Humphrey.
He's hanging in there.
Did you water him?
At some point.
Okay. We've been getting a fair amount of busy. It's too busy to... Anyway, what me and Mashi did was we ranked every mythic as hit or myth. And the definition of hit or myth is pretty subjective, you know, but we get to say what we want. So,
so again, with all of the rise cards kind of really polarizing in value, where it's like you have really expensive mythic rares and you have a lot of cards that are just not worth anything. And I keep telling people it's like opening these packs is kind of like opening lottery tickets, where it's like you hit big or you don't get anything.
Right.
So a lot of people are asking, you know, what cards could really hold value later? Like, what's a sleeper right now?
And of course, we talked about mythics just a couple weeks ago, and this is a good follow-up to that, because there we just kind of talked about mythics in general, but here we're going to go over every mythic and kind of see what we think about it, whether we think it's good for whatever reason or bad for whatever reason, and kind of explain what we think. So yeah,
thanks,
let's get into
it. Rise of the Eldrazi trusty player's guide from our Fat Packs. We'll start with All Is Dust.
See, I would say this is a hit. It not only captures a mythic flavor of, you know, turning everything into dust. It's a good card. It's going to see play, and it's not absurdly expensive. I don't know. I would rank it a hit.
I agree across the board. It's definitely a card that people will talk about. People will, like, try to find a way to play, but isn't going to be, like, game-breaking if you see it at the rare slot in draft, which might just be a concern for mythics. Like, you want to always take it.
Yeah.
And it's good.
I mean, no, we all agree.
Easy. Cast Through Time.
See, I think this is actually okay. I would actually rank this a hit. Not because I think it's a great card, because it certainly is not a very good card for, like, constructed purposes, but when I think of mythic cards, this, I think, fits the bill. It's borderline, because, you know, cards that, like, never see constructed play do feel like kind of a miss, or a myth, but I think Cast Through Time has a mythic effect. It's a powerful effect.
I'm going to take the opposite view on this one.
I think it's just a myth?
We drafted last night and opened up this card and passed around the table. It was like, oh, yeah, we got X number of mythics in our draft pool. I was like, what do you mean? This one's mythic? Like, to me, it's like the Maelstrom Nexus of this set. It's kind of like it showcases
but
the mechanic.
But I think it's okay for those cards to be mythic, because I think they do a powerful and unique ability that might not be... It might be... It's overcosted because it's dangerous, but, you know, people have fun with it. Like, people do play outside of tournaments.
I agree.
So
I think that
you just don't think it's, like, big enough or
EDH
flashy enough.
EDH implications when I think of this card. But I also think of it as a rare. I don't think of it as... I mean, again, it showcases a mechanic.
If it doesn't strike the mythic chord, then it's a myth. Yeah. And I understand what you're saying. So,
moving on, we have Emrakul, the Aeon's Torn.
I mean, a definite hit. Like, not only is he good to polymorph or Oath Out, people eventually hardcast him. His reshuffling ability means he's good in, like, the mill, you know, against mill decks. And overall, he perfectly encapsulates what a mythic should be.
He's completely agree.
Enormous, you know.
Obvious
frightening.
Hit. Pre-release card, like we all, yeah. Exactly.
Tentacles, anyway.
Easy. Moving on, Gideon Jura.
I think it's a hit because, you know, it's a very powerful card. It feels mythic. All the planeswalkers should be mythic, and rightfully so. My, of course, objection is the fact that it costs $60
or
whatever.
Right. I mean, no, again, we've talked at length about Gideon at this point, and I feel the same way. Like, the limited implications are more important to me than the constructed implications in this card, where it being a mythic is more important than being a rare.
Well, yeah, I think the fact that it's mythic is good for limited. You don't want to see Gideon that often, unless you have it, in which case you want to see it every game.
And it feels very mythic when someone, you know, you or your opponent slams it down.
I think
this
is what mythics should be also. It's unfortunate that it costs so much, but some mythics are going to cost a lot, and I think, I don't know, I'm okay with planeswalkers being super expensive. Other cards, maybe not so much.
I just don't
which
like,
we'll, I'm sure, get to later in
mean,
this segment.
I just don't like the fact that you would immediately associate planeswalker with being mythic and mythic with being good. Thus, like, every planeswalker has to be good. Like, that's the only downside.
So,
like, I want to see a rare planeswalker that's, you know, right, ho-hum.
That's fair.
All right, moving on. Hellcarver Demon.
I think this is more of a myth. It does have a pretty splashy and powerful effect, and it might actually be good enough, but overall it doesn't invoke the name Mythic to me for some reason.
I kind of feel the same way. It was like Xanthar Demon and M10, similar to
Hellcarver.
Yeah,
Xanthar Demon. I actually was looking at him when I was sorting through all my Mythics online. I have a lot of them. But I was like, Xanthar Demon, this guy's Mythic?
Yeah. Kind of felt the same way about Hellcarver Demon. I mean, it has a little more flair because it does something really cool, kind of like black card that would potentially mine Desire at the top of your library.
Right.
But I think it could be a rare, and I would be fine with it.
All right. What else we got?
Kind of a myth. Kargan Dragonlord.
I think this is a hit. He's not been as absurd as people thought, but I think he's still going to be quite good. And he feels pretty mythic to me. He's a guy who turns into a dragon. I mean, I think Figure of Destiny would have been okay at mythic. So
I think Figure of Destiny would be okay at mythic too, but again, instant speed versus sorcery speed level up. I look at Kargan Dragonlord kind of like a rare.
Yeah, I mean, when I rank cards like hit or myth, to some extent, I think the flavor actually matters to me, which is weird because, you know, it's not something I usually pay a ton of attention to, but he feels mythic to me.
Interesting.
A dragon lord.
All right. Well, agree to disagree on that one. Colony Hydra.
I think this is more of a myth than anything else.
Really?
Green has a lot of big creatures, and this is just another big creature. It doesn't do anything really even that special.
See, this is where the opposite argument from Kargan Dragonlord to me. It's like you look at the artwork, you look at the casting card, just the card physically.
I mean, yeah. It's enormous, yeah.
It's like the artwork, everything lends itself to being like a mythic rare. I mean, everyone's like, oh, that guy and Primal Crux, they come together. It's like
I just don't feel cards like this that don't do anything very interesting. I have a hard time seeing them as being epic just because, yeah.
Big trampley green guys are not right. In no way ever mythic to you. All right.
Not necessarily no way, but not ones that don't really do anything besides being big and trampling.
Embercool's little cousin Kozilek is also mythic.
I think they hit pretty well on all the big Eldrazi. I mean, all the things that apply to Embercool apply to him, except that he gets cast a lot more often.
Definitely. Easy. Lighthouse Chronologist.
I'm kind of undecided on this. On the one hand, taking extra turns is pretty mythic. Like that, I like that they're reserving that for the mythic slot with like Time Warp or whatever. But on the other hand, it also dies pretty easily and doesn't seem. It seems a little puny to be a mythic.
See, I think this is a hit. I think an ability like that, especially with multiplayer implications, the card was written to be so epic or mythic when you play it. That I like where it ends up, and I'm not usually.
I'm willing to give it a hit also, just because again, the taking extra turn is something that should be special and reserved for mostly mythics. So,
Linvala, Keeper of Silence.
I think this is kind of a myth. She's kind of small. I mean, she has a powerful effect in the game, but she doesn't, again, feel very epic. You can have small mythic creatures like Lighthouse Chronologist, for example, but Linvala doesn't seem to do anything that spectacular. Like. Is she really that different from Archon of Redemption or whatever that wasn't mythic? So,
The Cursed Totem ability has been strong.
It's just like a small kind of utility-ish mid-range creature. It doesn't feel like it does anything that exciting.
Okay, yeah. I can see that being a myth, definitely. Nirkana Revenant?
This is also something that I'm not...
A bit of a gray area?
Yeah, like, on the other hand, it does have the Mana Flare effect, you know, Heartbeat of Spring or whatever. It doubles your mana.
Mana Flare, please.
Yeah. That our new viewers might be more familiar with Heartbeat of Spring since, you know, it's seen some play more recently.
Okay. I like to refer to it as Gauntlet of Power. But.
Okay, sure. But anyway, Nirkana Revenant does offer a pretty game-changing effect. On the other hand, I see it and I see a shade, and shades aren't that exciting.
But it's like the most mythic shade possible because it doubles all of your mana. It's like everything you want your shade to be able to do is get bigger quicker. And it can do other things. It can cast big consumed spirits. It can activate your invokers quicker. I think it's a hit.
All right, I guess we're going to have to be divided on this one. I think it's going to...
That's fine. Sarkhan the Mad.
He's another good hit. He's a planeswalker. His flavor fits pretty well. They all has to do with dragons. He only goes down. He does a lot of interesting things. So I think he's actually going to be good and constructed, but not absurdly good, so his price tag's all seem to be reasonable.
Seems fairly obvious to me.
So he does everything a mythic should do.
Exactly.
Easy. Plus, he talks about dragons a lot.
Transcendent Master.
I think this is a hit. The artwork, the ability, it all seems mythic to me. I mean, I think the card might be decent and constructed, but even if it isn't, it still seems like a good candidate for a mythic rare.
I think it's a hit for limited. I think it's a miss for constructed. A myth for constructed. Ulamog, same thing as Kozilek and Emrakul, right?
Like I said, the infinite gear, gyre, gur.
Whatever. Something. And lastly, Vengevine.
Vengevine. Well, we've talked about this at length, and... I've got to say myth. It does not feel mythic to me.
It should be a rare. It's a myth.
So so people don't get bored of the Vengevine conversation, I think we'll leave it at that.
All right.
But yeah, there we go. Hit or myth, and let us know what you think we got wrong.
Thanks for watching.
See you next time.